Okay, you can start.
He said agenda two, he's showing my desktop as one, but he said he's trying to.
Jim.
How does he get them? How does he contact it?
The effect, the powerful effect that he had on a nation and on.
See, your mom needs to see this, your sister needs to see it, my sister needs to see it.
Jim, bring it back over here.
Think I'm crazy, they think I'm crazy.
I know my mother was saying.
I knew he was a man, I knew he was.
Think you guys could kind of turn it up a little louder, Kelly.
I never thought he'd hear shit, and this is what he wrote. I was deeply touched by your letter and want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for your warm words and thoughts. Like you, I too believe that the day is getting closer when the good Lord will do justice to the Romanian people. And I, like you, I strongly believe that all of us who care about that once marvelous corner of the world should do something to help him. I can probably understand more easily than other Americans your feeling that people living in freedom often take freedom for granted, like the air they breathe. Red Horizons tries to open a window for the American reader looking out on the incredible life at the court of any Soviet bloc leader. I have dedicated it to all political prisoners. Sorry. Kept hostage against their will, who are crying for help from the free world. Once again, I want to say that I was deeply moved by your letter, as well as by your strong belief in freedom. Thank you for taking the trouble of sharing your feelings with me, even without knowing if your letter would ever reach me. With kindest regards, Yon Mihai Pachipa.
That morning, as I looked out into the sun, I wondered again if I could actually go through in it. For some reason, it seemed brighter that day. As head of the Romanian espionage service, I knew my knowledge would be a valuable asset to the West, but it would also make me a highly wanted man by my Soviet masters. As I got closer to the U.S. Embassy, I could hear my heart pounding in my ears. My mouth felt as if I had been freeze-dried. I knew that once I stepped through that door, there would be no going back. I would never again be able to return to the family, to the friends, or to the country I loved. But the darkness I had lived with for so long was eating away at my soul. I knew I must jump off this cliff, and I prayed I would land alive. And I still wondered, could I make this leap of faith?
Despite fear and deep reservations, Lieutenant General Yon Mihai Pachepa stepped into the U.S. Embassy and requested asylum. The CIA officer on duty was quick to understand the ramifications of such defection. Under the cloak of night and high security, the highest-ranking Soviet bloc official ever to defect to the West was secretly whisked out of Germany. Although the price he paid for defecting was high, with a $2 million bounty on his head, multiple assassination attempts on his life, and is still hiding to this day, Lieutenant General Yon Mihai Pachepa is now speaking out. This is the true story of one man and the truth he revealed to the free world. The truth of a highly secret strategy called disinformation, an insidious formula to undermine and destroy Western civilization. A strategy still at work today. Prepare yourself for an eye-opening revelation as we unravel the world of disinformation.
Disinformation is the kernel of truth around which you weave a tissue of falsehood.
And that twist with the lie is disinformation.
People are manipulated. The media is manipulated and manipulating.
This informer has no respect for leaders.
Disinformation is a very long-term
influence campaign, to influence American attitudes, to influence public opinion. This information appears to come from a trusted source. But why? Why the bones?
Disinformation flows from the delusion that you can change the world. Very sinister.
Disinformation has been going on for years and years. If you can get the New York Times to release your misinformation, it becomes disinformation.
It's deceptive, it's disgusting, it's despicable, and it's part of their political program.
It's part of an overall strategy.
And we see disinformation as a way to sidestep us, particularly in the intelligence world.
Disinformation has been part of the art of war going back to ancient times.
Disinformation is pervasive. It's pervasive in our society and in our culture.
It's a form of psychological warfare.
Mihai's mother loved her husband, and as a woman of faith, she prayed for him daily. Her moral worldview in a right and just Christian God was ingrained in her son from an early age, a seed of compassion that would someday bear fruit. The young Pacheppa also learned a love for music and art, and at the age of 9, he could play Beethoven's difficult Kreutzer Sonata on his violin.
Pacheppa was the highest-ranking defector of the Cold War then, and still, he's a remarkable man. That is one of the great acting jobs in human history, to have already begun decades before your internal migration away from the belief system of the Romanian Communist Party, and to carry on with your job in such a way as to acquire a great deal of information that was useful to the West, and it was very useful. He was the most senior intelligence defector that we had during the Cold War as a head of Romanian intelligence. And for years before that, he was very senior and was in a lot of the meetings at the time of the Cuban Missile Crisis, for example. So he's a fascinating individual and a brave man.
Witnesses like General Pacheppa are very important to our defensive arsenals.
My father's lifelong dream had been to go to America. He spent most of his career working at the Bucharest affiliate of General Motors, and he was firmly determined that one day he would gather up his family and immigrate to Detroit. Trapped by the war and then by the Soviet occupation, he was forced to give up that dream. But not before passing his love for America along to me. The moment that the United States reopened its embassy after the war, I became one of its enthusiastic visitors. I didn't realize it would be 33 years before I would fulfill my father's dream.
Pacheppa was born into a world on the brink of disaster and tremendous upheaval. In the impoverished country of Germany, a charismatic leader and his nationalist party were gaining power. And in Russia, a man who would become the greatest mass murderer in history was solidifying his iron rule. The war to end all wars had ushered in the age of totalitarianism and would bring about the most heinous genocides of modern history. As a boy, Mihai knew nothing of the growing cancer called communism that would someday consume his world and nearly destroy his life. Communism had been born in the mind of Karl Marx, and in 1917, it became a nightmare on Earth in Russia. The release in 1848 of the Communist Manifesto, the most famous pamphlet in the history of the world, would usher in a new religion, a religion based on man as God and government as deliverer.
These great or terrible messianic movements, Nazism, Communism, Socialism, all appear after Darwin. They appear when organized religion declines. People need a meaning in their lives, and these are substitutes for religion. And what makes them so dangerous, because they believe they can establish the kingdom of heaven in this world, and they will do anything that it takes to achieve that. And of course, if you believe that you lead mankind into the Garden of Eden, what crime wouldn't you commit, and what lie wouldn't you commit? And if you don't go along with the program, we're going to put you in a gulag, or we're going to put you up against a wall and shoot you. And that's the morality of the left, that there's nothing more dangerous than people who think they're God.
The communist doctrine, put to use by Vladimir Lenin, was taken to a new level of terror and fraud by Joseph Stalin. The result? An international ideology that snuffed out the lives of over 150 million people in the 20th century, twice the combined death toll of the two world wars. Vladimir Lenin infamously stated that the only morality that his Bolsheviks recognized was that which furthered their interests. This meant that lying was fully justified and that any target was legitimate. Russia became the first major power to make deception a permanent national policy. That deception included propaganda and a uniquely Soviet tactic of disinformation. But how is disinformation different and so much more insidious than other forms of political deception? Disinformation is a lie spread not by the liar, but by another source, by a legitimate source that many believe in. This makes it not only harder to discern, but can give it an often endless life of its own. The lie thus becomes a rewritten history. For example, if during the Vietnam War, the Soviet Union put out a story that American soldiers were carrying out atrocities reminiscent of Genghis Khan, the free world would recognize that as misinformation or propaganda. But if a U.S. soldier were to spread that and a newspaper carry it, then many citizens might believe the slander and question America's involvement. Since World War II, disinformation has been the Kremlin's most effective secret weapon in its war on the West. Stalin turned the practice into a science deeply rooted in Russia's soil and history. Born in the 18th century, disinformation was the fruit of the passionate love affair between Catherine the Great and Prince Potemkin, her principal political and military advisor. In 1787, Potemkin took the Empress on a tour of the Crimea, which he had been instrumental in annexing from the Turks. In order to impress her, Potemkin had arranged for fake villages to be erected along the route that Catherine would take. Down through the ages, everyone who has sat on the Kremlin throne has utilized disinformation to transform his country into a monument to himself. Controlling all expressions of religion was central to that ambition. This manipulation of religion dates back to the 16th century, when Ivan the Terrible had himself crowned as Russia's first Tsar, as well as head of the Russian Orthodox Church. Russia's manipulation and persecution of religion came to an apex with the creation of the Protocols of the Elders of Zion, perhaps the most resilient piece of disinformation ever compiled.
This book purports to be the words of psychopathic Jewish world leaders that are conspiring to enslave the entire world.
The Tsarists, who were anti-Semites to a fault, engineered the fabrication of a document they called the Protocols of the Elders of Zion for the purpose of sustaining one of the grounds for hating the Jews and engaging in pogroms against them, namely that they ran the world. And it is an extraordinary piece of work, not only because of the use that the Tsarists and those in Russia made of it, but the application of it to this very day by people who continue to find it useful for discrediting or undermining or justifying assaults against the Jews.
Judaism gave us the rule of law, you know, comes out of the Sinai. It's one of the reasons I think that anti-Semitism is always one of the first refuges of the scoundrels. They need to undermine that idea that the law is above the ruler. And one way they do that is to go after Jews and Judaism.
I'm just describing as a student of Soviet ideology, I know what I'm talking about. It started under Stalin, it got enhanced under Nikita Khrushchev, and obviously anti-Zionism became a fundamental underpinning of the Soviet ideology.
Soon after Lenin died in 1924, Stalin revived the protocols and made it the basis for his anti-Semitic purges. Over 7 million Russians were framed as Zionist spies and executed at Stalin's order. In Germany, Hitler used the protocols to blame the Jews for all of the disasters that had befallen the country. The Nazis translated the protocols into many new languages and flooded the world with them to create the impression of a Jewish conspiracy aimed at world domination, thus justifying the persecution of Jews as a matter of self-defense.
If you read some of the documents of the Nazis and newspapers of the Nazis and so on, you will see that they considered the protocols, Hitler himself, considered the protocols to be a historical evidence for their anti-Semitic fantasies.
The use of disinformation to promote anti-Semitism did not, however, end with the defeat of Nazi Germany. In the late 1960s, KGB chief Yuri Andropov gave the protocols a new life in the Middle East.
During the Cold War, disinformation became a national policy. More people in the Soviet bloc worked for the disinformation machinery than for the Soviet army and the defense industry put together. The bloc's intelligence community alone had well over 1 million officers and several million informants around the world. All were involved in deceiving the West, as well as their own people.
Let us be aware that while they preach the supremacy of the state, declare its omnipotence over individual man, and predict its eventual domination of all peoples on the earth, they are the focus of evil in the modern world.
President Ronald Reagan shocked people when he called the Soviet Union the evil empire. But it was evil. And the disinformation operation of its KGB and the whole intelligence apparatus was a key part of advancing that evil agenda.
Basically, the Soviet government, it was extremely successful in brainwashing millions and millions of people.
On September 1st, 1939, Germany invaded Poland and set the world at war once again. 16 days later, Russia invaded Poland from the east in accordance with a secret protocol in the pact between Stalin and Hitler. This non-aggression agreement also gave Stalin the right to take parts of Romania and other parts of the Baltic. Without warning, on June 22, 1941, Germany terminated the pact and invaded the Soviet Union. Stalin's trust in Hitler cost Russia dearly. He even ignored intelligence warnings that Germany was likely to attack, believing such reports to be disinformation. Within 6 months, the Soviet military had suffered 4.3 million casualties, and Germany had captured 3 million Soviet prisoners. Although it was the most dedicated ally of Germany, Romania eventually turned to the Allied side. On August 23, 1944, just as the Red Army was penetrating the Moldavian front, King Michael led a successful coup to depose the Antonescu dictatorship. This resulted in a split of the country between those that still supported Germany and those that supported the new government.
Many in Romania had been fooled by Hitler, his propaganda, his disinformation. But my father, we could see him for what he was. I learned then to hate dictators. When Romania joined the Allies at the age of 16, I found myself fighting the Germans with a gun in my hands. 4 years of war squeezed Romania like a sponge, and what little remained had been stolen by the Soviet army. Despite the war, I finished high school, and in 1947 was number 3 on the list of students admitted to the Polytechnica University of Bucharest. With the war over, I thought their nightmare had ended. Little did I know what was ahead for me and my country.
From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain had descended across the continent.
The Communist Party of all fifth columns constitute a growing challenge and peril to Christian civilization.
Churchill's Fulton speech of 1946, which actually finally made America and Britain recognize that there is ideological war, whether they want it or not, and they deliberately accepted this fact and started to fight this war.
Following the war, Russia held the upper hand as the Red Army occupied and held much of Eastern Europe with a military three times greater than the Allied forces in the West. Yet, at the Yalta Conference, as part of the Big Three, Stalin agreed that all liberated European and former Axis satellite countries would hold free elections. Soviet Minister Molotov expressed worry that the Yalta Agreement's wording might impede Russia's plans. Stalin responded, "Never mind. We'll do it our own way later." Stalin knew he had another secret disinformation weapon in his arsenal, a tactic called framing. Many believe that the worst damage from Soviet intelligence operations against the West has been the theft of highly classified secrets. In actuality, the worst and often irreparable damage done to the free world has been caused by the Kremlin's disinformation operations, designed to change the past. In KGB jargon, changing people's pasts was called framing, and it was a highly classified disinformation specialty. Both Lenin and Stalin successfully purged millions of rivals, opponents, and uncooperative citizens by framing them as traitors or Zionist spies. In 1945, Stalin decided to use his disinformation machine to take control of Eastern Europe. Nazi sympathizers were considered the most vile people at that time, and to be framed as such meant to be ostracized, arrested, or to be sentenced to death. Stalin used this black art of framing on numerous innocents.
"I saw as Romania's heroic King Michael was framed as a Nazi collaborator and Western spy and forced to abdicate. Within just a few years, virtually the entire Romanian economy was running on stolen property. With control of the media, the government launched powerful disinformation offensives to persuade everyone that Romania could be changed into a prosperous country just by confiscating others' wealth.
And Romania was supposed to be an Allied control after 45. Why was that so much a free hand given to Stalin? That's my position."
"The Sovietization of Eastern Europe was accomplished by the Kremlin through subversive framing operations. All the initial leaders of the Eastern European countries were absolute nobodies, some even criminals, but all swore loyalty to the Kremlin's religion, Marxism, Leninism, Stalinism. The Soviet disinformation machinery thus framed the useful ones as national heroes, and the anti-communists became Nazis.
Huge crowds such as these shown here gather in the square before St. Peter's in Rome, where His Holiness Pope Pius XII speaks to them. This year, 400,000 listened intently to his solemn Easter message. In it, he warned the world that a time of serious crisis is at hand, and gravely cautioned his listeners against red factions who would seize power in Italy and deny Christianity its right to exist."
He despised the notion of communism, and he despised the notion of godless countries. And so he was the enemy, the supreme enemy.
He knew what communism meant, and it brought the church to its knees wherever it was, brought people to their knees.
For Stalin's plan to succeed, he knew he must destroy one of his greatest enemies. The church within those countries was his next target. The war between communism and the Catholic Church is almost as old as communism itself. In Russia, Lenin killed thousands of priests and closed most churches to make Marxism-Leninism the country's sole religion.
"Most Americans and most people in the Western world do not understand what communism is about. Communism is first, way before economic system, is a religion. It has a god. His name is Lenin. It has a church. Its name is the Communist Party of the USSR. It has its prophets, it has its rituals, it has its texts, it has the Bible, it has everything. Lenin is in you, Lenin is in me, Lenin is everywhere. So just substitute Jesus or God and you'll understand where it comes from. They stole everything from Judaism, actually. So I believed in my God. Lenin was the most important hero, the most important person in my childhood. I was willing to inform on my parents. I was a good patriot. I was willing to die to destroy imperialism in America."
On June 3rd, 1945, Radio Moscow proclaimed that the leader of the Catholic Church, Pope Pius XII, had been Hitler's pope, insinuating that he had been an ally of the Nazis during World War II. This was the first salvo of a calculated operation designed to smear the reigning Pope in the eyes of the world. Radio Moscow's insinuation fell flat as a pancake. Churchill called him the greatest man of our time. And Albert Einstein wrote, "Before I had not been interested in the church, but today I felt a great admiration for the church, which alone has had the courage to stand against the Hitlerian onslaught on liberty." In the 1960s, the Kremlin tried again with a new generation. Central to that framing effort, codenamed Operation C-12, was the 1963 theatrical play, The Deputy, written by the leftist German playwright, Rolf Hakut. It had the KGB's hands all over it, and it proceeded to promote the idea that Pius XII was Hitler's Pope.
If you plug in, it's not just a play, but it's the whole Soviet disinformation mechanism behind the play, promoting the play, doing books about the play, having the play translated and produced, and making kids in high school in the Soviet Union and other satellite nations go see it each year.
This man is from ground zero in Rome, surrounded by hostile forces.
No one seriously doubted where the Pope stood during the war. This all came up afterwards, after the Soviet plot came in, beginning in 1963, with the play of The Deputy.
They used the network of the Roman Catholic Church to save Jewish lives.
Every rectory, every convent, every school throughout Rome became a sanctuary for Jews. In Rome, they saved about 8,000 Jews that way, which had one of the highest percentages of anywhere people being saved. There are a lot of testimony from Jewish people who say, you know, I was there, or my relatives were there.
The Concordat that was signed with Germany enabled the church to save converted Jews. He was infiltrated by spies and still managed to save Jewish lives, which were not part of his flock. How the world came to change its opinion of him is outrageous. The Valkyrie attempt on Hitler's life, 1944. We have the documents of the Kaltenbrunner report. It names Spicelli and his secretary Lieber as co-conspirators. Why? Because they were. They actually said that they would not interfere to negotiate a peace unless Hitler was dead.
He was hailed at the liberation of Rome, at the end of the war, at the time of his death in 1958. There are letters that the Holy See was inundated with letters and tributes and thanks and stuff. And everyone, and that's 1958. By 1963, he's a villain. How does that happen? Well, it happens because it was an orchestrated campaign.
In January 1951, just before I was about to graduate from college, I was drafted and became an officer of Romania's political police, the Securitate. At 22 years old, my whole life had suddenly been turned upside down. At the time, I really knew nothing about the Securitate. I was a chemical engineer. My father once told me that if I wanted to be different, I had to be strong enough to remain different to the end and not back down. But the moment I needed to be strong enough, I wasn't. Thus began a 28-year nightmare. During those early years, I could see night after night security officers being sent out to arrest people whose names were changed to numbers and who were then buried in jails or concentration camps. They were made to disappear from a society that they or their parents or their children dared to criticize. I was not involved in these operations, but I could see how socialism was built behind a daily propaganda, behind secret decrees and show trials, and often sentences without trials. A system that nullified elementary justice and human rights.
I discovered over the years, it's impossible for Americans to really get it. It's not anything that you can imagine.
When you are arrested as dissident in the Soviet Union and were under interrogation, for about 1 year, you would be totally isolated, completely. Neither your lawyer nor one else would have access to you. Only KGB. So why it was so? Because the KGB would try to use this isolation to provide to you a lot of disinformation, as they would smuggle false messages and information to them saying that their wife betrayed them, you know, and wasn't faithful for them. So they would use all such nasty tricks, you know. It's all part of disinformation. Why they would do it? They want to break your will, you know. They want you to give up while you are under interrogation.
Lenin originated a new disinformation program in 1902. He created a number of mass organizations intended for wide membership and which, therefore, can be as loose and as public as possible.
In order, however, to appeal to much larger audiences, they created front organizations.
Headquartered outside of Russia and pretending to be independent international entities, these tentacles of Soviet power grew into homegrown disinformation efforts that still haunt us today.
Organizations that had as their mission to conquer the minds in the West, but not in a direct way like the Communist parties.
When I was granted political asylum in the USA, I found out that most people in American intelligence, the military, and the media did not even know what disinformation really meant. Because of that, few outsiders knew how these front organizations operated, or that they were in fact disinformation outlets financed and managed by the KGB community. Even fewer know that this immense machinery is still alive today.
The smart leaders would not allow on their platforms people who would mess with the front group message. The long-term goal is to create a communist United States. But they wouldn't allow into their literature or on their platforms people calling for a communist United States because they want as broad, they want to suck in as broad a group as possible.
In 1949, the most influential such group was founded and given the respectable name of the World Peace Council. Its mission was to prove that the U.S. was a warmongering Zionist country financed by Jewish money and run by a greedy Council of the Elders of Zion.
And one of the magnets to attract by disinformation supporters for this front was peace.
In the 1970s, all WPC national branches initiated demonstrations against the American war in Vietnam. An international appeal in typically Soviet-style language issued by the World Peace Council called upon the people of the world to organize unprecedented mobilizations against American imperialism.
The World Peace Council was a very big organization, and it seemed international. We knew it was a cover organization for the Soviet Union and part of their propaganda machine.
With the demise of the Soviet Union in 1991, Moscow newspapers reported the World Peace Council had received policy guidance and 90% of its funding from the Kremlin. Over the years, the Soviet-affiliated World Workers' Party created several front organizations such as ANSWER. ANSWER has helped to organize many of the largest anti-war demonstrations in the United States, including demonstrations of hundreds of thousands against the war in Iraq.
If you say that you want America to lose the Cold War, or you think that the attacks of 9/11 were justified, or that you want a revolution in America, you know, you'll isolate yourself. So leftists never say what their agendas are. They tell you that they're for peace. We have these anti-war movements, which are nothing of the sort. The last big anti-war movement was about the war in Iraq. It wasn't an anti-war movement. It wasn't a peace movement. There was never a demonstration in front of the Iraqi embassy calling on Saddam Hussein to obey the 16, then 17 UN resolutions to honor the truce he had signed in the Gulf War, which is what the conflict with Iraq was about. Not a single demonstration. All the demonstrations were attacks on America. The anti-war movement is the hate America left. That's what it is. And a lot of well-meaning people who are duped into thinking that this is really a peace demonstration.
Most believe that disinformation is an obsolete Cold War phenomena, but the continued life and growth of many front groups shows that belief to be disinformation.
Many front groups also began as part of a liberation movement against imperialist governments and bourgeois religions. These revolutionary movements were often secretly organized, infiltrated, and sponsored by the KGB, and worked from directives dictated by Moscow. The Palestine Liberation Organization, the National Liberation Army of Bolivia, the National Liberation Army of Colombia, the Secret Army for Liberation of Armenia, and the Democratic Front for the Liberation of Palestine are but a few of the liberation groups that have terrorized the world and outlived their KGB creators. In 1961, the Kremlin opened another front in their war on religion by secretly infiltrating the World Council of Churches. From its beginning, Marxism itself was a religion that could coexist with no other, and in a basic sense, reads like a Christian heresy. In traditional Christianity, the glorifying of human nature takes place because of Christ's incarnation. In Marxism, the state takes Christ's place. Marxism even offers a theory of sin and salvation, with private property as the sin and collective ownership the salvation. As such, the state becomes a church that dispenses grace.
ACLU has done a lot of damage to this country. I think taking off the Ten Commandments out of every high school in America is horrible. I mean, I ask my people once in a while, tell me, is America better off today with Christianity in the corner, pushed down?
Building on one small truth, that God cares about the poor, the Kremlin invented liberation theology, one of the greatest disinformation campaigns against Christianity. Liberation theology proposes to combine the teachings of Jesus with the teachings of Marx as a way of justifying violent revolution to overthrow capitalism, thus becoming a version of Christianity that seems to endorse socialism. By the late 1960s, the WCC had essentially abandoned traditional Christian beliefs and instead focused on political and economic liberation. The WCC and eventually the National Council of Churches came under the authority of the International Department of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union and received most of their funding from the Soviet Peace Fund. In March of 2008, liberation theology came front and center in America.
No, no, no! Not God bless America! God damn America!
The whole world watched in disbelief as the Reverend Jeremiah Wright, the spiritual advisor of Senator Obama, screamed at the television screen. He accused the United States of America of deliberately spreading the AIDS sickness to kill black people. He insinuated that America had actually brought about the 9/11 attacks with its own terrorism.
The Democrats' damage control machinery simply brushed away Wright's statement, calling it a staple of black churches. But no, it was created years ago by the KGB disinformation machinery. I have good reason to believe that the Democratic Party's tolerance of such is the result of that party's growing tendency to swallow disinformation operations and to give them American cover.
In the 1950s, the FBI produced a 100-plus page classified report on the subject of communist campaigns. The Bureau defined campaigns as concentrated, continuous, and concerted succession of agitation and propaganda activities, specifically devised and timed to sway public opinion. All communist campaigns are intended to arouse, influence, and mobilize as many people as possible to further communist goals. That end goal, to ensure the triumph of Soviet power in the United States. The communists excelled at such disinformation campaigns. Operation Abolition was probably the most successful, as it worked to discredit and abolish the House Committee on Un-American Activities investigations. They framed their accusers as fascists, Nazis, and even racists who were allegedly unfairly hounding and maligning people by investigating their ties to Moscow.
The Communist Party of the United States is a fifth column if there ever was one.
Are you or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
America's liberals and progressives, led by the ACLU, came together to find their demon not in the pro-communists who defended Stalin as he murdered tens of millions, but in the anti-communists who tried to tell the truth about Stalin, his murderous state, and his secret supporters in America. Of special interest and engaged in this campaign was Frank Marshall Davis, a card-carrying member of the Communist Party USA. Still today, the likes of Davis himself continue to be protected by liberals who portray him as an innocent civil rights crusader, hounded by the McCarthyites. In the 1970s, he would go on to mentor a young Hawaiian boy named Barack Obama. The disinformation curiously continues.
One of the characteristics of disinformation is perversity. The goal is everything, and the means, whatever means can be used, they will be used.
President Truman announces an atomic explosion detected somewhere in Russia.
By the end of 1949, the international stage had shifted into Stalin's favor. In August of that year, Russia's first atomic bomb had successfully detonated. And in October, Mao Zedong proclaimed the establishment of the People's Republic of China. The new global alliance between the two countries gave Stalin greater confidence, and he approved North Korea's secret plans for invasion.
A highly trained and well-equipped North Korean army swarmed across the 38th parallel to attack unprepared South Korean defenders. caught off guard, they were all but overwhelmed, until the United Nations took its historic vote to intervene.
The Cold War had become hot. But before it had ended, Stalin was gone. March 1953, the Soviet Union mourns the death of Stalin. For almost three decades, he had ruled supreme. Now they must learn to carry on without him.
At that time, I was already a Soviet bloc intelligence officer, but I was not yet aware that a Soviet leader's image was so important that he would go to any lengths, even to the point of killing and imprisoning millions, rewriting history, destroying institutions, manipulating religion, and changing traditions, all in developing his cult of personality. Stalin's successor, Nikita Khrushchev, began his reign by executing the whole leadership of Stalin's political police as traitors. The chief Soviet intelligence advisor to Romania, General Alexander Sokorovsky, was appointed to head foreign intelligence in Moscow. In Romania, he had been my de facto boss, and so fate brought me into Khrushchev's inner circle. As I would be pushed to the top of Romania's foreign intelligence, I would learn of some of Khrushchev's most important foreign political projects.
Nikita Khrushchev was certainly the most controversial Soviet to reign in the Kremlin. In a disinformation operation called the Secret Speech, he unmasked Stalin's crimes. But his hands were far from clean. Khrushchev's close association with Stalin's Great Purge made him aware of what political crime could accomplish. The practice of resorting to political assassinations remained with Khrushchev, and he made it a main instrument of his own foreign policy.
Many times I heard Khrushchev say, both when he was sober and when he was drunk, that Stalin had made one inexcusable mistake. He had turned his political police against the Soviet Union's own people. Our enemies were not in the Soviet Union, Khrushchev would explain. America's millionaires are the ones who are determined to wipe communism off the face of the earth. They were our deadly enemies. They were the rabid dogs of imperialism.
Marxist movements that have occurred in Central and South America, as well as the Caribbean, Cuba specifically, were all part of Russia's plan to dominate our hemisphere and ultimately encroach on the security of the United States.
I was made chief of a new department for science and technology in 1959. I was happy with my new job and still believed I could help my native country. I had with my own ears heard Khrushchev say, stealing from capitalism is moral, comrades. Stealing from our enemy is our duty. And for many years after that, I heard Ceausescu saying the same thing, that stealing from capitalism was a Marxist duty. Both Khrushchev and Ceausescu rose to lead their countries without ever having earned a single penny in any productive job. Neither man had the slightest idea about what made an economy work. And each believed that stealing from the rich was the magic wand that would cure economic ills.
Let every nation know, whether it wishes us well or ill, that we shall pay any price, bear any burden, meet any hardship, support any friend, oppose any foe, to assure the survival and the success of liberty.
In the mid or late 1950s, the Soviet bloc intelligence services were ordered to recruit American servicemen. We found that sergeants were much more accessible than higher ranking officers. And what you would call loose women were used as spotters at bars and nightclubs located near US bases in Germany and Japan. Many of these sergeants, as we called them, were able to provide excellent information if given the right guidance.
Lee Harvey Oswald was an American serviceman stationed at a top-secret U-2 airbase in Japan in 1957. As a Marine Corps radar operator, Oswald possessed clues to the flight altitude of the high-flying spy plane. It was no coincidence, therefore, that the Soviet Union shot down a U-2 in May of 1960. He had an unusual fascination of Marxism. So at the end of his duty in Japan, Oswald decided to live in the workers' paradise. In October of 1959, he defected to the Soviet Union and remained there for 3 years.
During this time, Oswald was intensively indoctrinated, trained in ancient communications and weaponry. given a Soviet wife who was trained to assist him, and then dispatched off to Texas.
From the failed Bay of Pigs invasion of Cuba, Kennedy earned the KGB codename Pig. Bolstered by that failure, Khrushchev decided to bully the president and force the Americans to give up West Berlin. He thought Kennedy was a willing dupe, but Kennedy proved otherwise.
The source of world trouble and tension is Moscow, not Berlin. And if war begins, it will have begun in Moscow and not Berlin. For the choice of peace or war is largely theirs, not ours.
In August of 1961, Khrushchev ordered the construction of a wall to end the exodus of East Berliners to the West. In response, Kennedy ordered the mobilization of forces in West Berlin. By October 27th, Soviet and American tanks stood 100 meters apart on either side of the checkpoint. The Berlin crisis of 1961 ended peacefully the next day, following a Soviet understanding to withdraw tanks. Kennedy had shown that neither he nor the free world would back down from Khrushchev.
All free men, wherever they may live, are citizens of Berlin. And therefore, as a free man, I take pride in the words, Ich bin ein Berliner.